Well, good morning, friends. I hate to break that up. I love to see you visiting and all of that, but we gotta get on with this good stuff. Today's text is like, are you ready? This is a challenging text. Some of you have been reading ahead, which is a good. I always encourage that you read forward, kind of get this germinating in your soul, so that when we get to it at this time on Sunday mornings, that you're prepared. You've already been thinking, and if you read ahead, you're like, this is a challenging text. What are we going to do with this? Well, this is what we're going to do with it. We're going to read it, and then we're going to expound on it, because that's what we do, right? So real complex, right? But it is really a challenge. But can I got to clear my conscience here. Because we preach expositionally, that means you just teach through the Bible. You just teach through the text for that morning. And last week's text was enormous. I think the technical term is ginormous. And there was at least one verse that I didn't even touch. And when I was all done with the day, I kind of did some reflecting, and I realized I didn't touch that area, and it's a very important area. And so can I clear my conscience and draw your attention to Acts chapter 8, verse 2? Okay, I love that. I just saw a bunch of heads go down to look to their Bibles. Nice job. Nice job. You need to bring your Bibles to church. That's a good thing. And so look at verse 2. It says, remember, Stephen was, in last week's text, we read, he became the first martyr of the Christian church. He gave his life. He was murdered for his faith. He would not divest himself of his trust in Christ, and so they killed him for it. And that spread this massive persecution that we'll look at again this week, and what are the ramifications or what happened because of that. But after he was killed, it says in verse 2, devout men buried Stephen and made great lamentation over him. So I talked about how he saw Jesus standing at the right hand of God, and he was gloriously received into his eternal reward, and we made a deal out of that, and that's all right and true. But I didn't deal with verse 2, that the reality that the people that were left, Stephen was loved by these people. They were his friends. They were the part of the family of God, and they loved him, and they grieved the loss of their dear friend. And I left that alone. And so I think I don't want us to have the impression that when I say just, I don't mean to make it sound like it's a simple thing or not a great thing. But just because God has gifted us with eternal life doesn't mean we're not sorrowful when people die or when bad things happen on earth, right? These people had a good balance here. They recognize he's enjoying the gift of eternal life that God had promised to him. He was well received, and yet there's great lamentation. They're sorrowful. They're grieving the loss of their friend. And I didn't want to leave that undone. The gift of eternal life, well received with great joy, does not annul the sorrow that people feel when somebody that they care about passes away, right? So we're supposed to grieve. But we don't grieve without hope. We don't grieve hopelessly, right? So now my conscience is clear. Thank you, Lord, for gracious people that allow me to backtrack. All right, now today's passage, like I said, it's a big challenge. You're gonna get exposed, which is what expositional preaching is. You expose people to the text. You're gonna get exposed to some challenging thoughts here. But the gospel spreading from its hub, its original location, which was Jerusalem, and now it's finding its way into Samaria, which was in accord with the commission that Christ gave his church, right? But the main idea this morning is just, this is kind of the overarching theme or the meaning of this whole text, and we'll look through it as we go, but this is the main idea. Wherever the gospel is spread, its purity must be preserved. Wherever the gospel is spread, its purity must be preserved. It's imperative that we protect the purity of the gospel, that we don't allow it to get tainted or polluted by other things. And so what we see here is where it originated from, with the apostles in Jerusalem, its purity had been preserved, but now it's spreading to Samaria, to another region, to another people group. And what we're going to see is that the church was very intent about making sure that that pure gospel was preserved. And it's important for us as well, friends. So think about it like this. Think about it in terms of like an operating room. Now, we hope to not ever have to have any operations, but in the event that you have to have an operation, you want the operation room to be pure. You want it to be uncontaminated. Take a look at this little picture here. Who would want to get an operation in that operating room? Like, nobody would. Whatever sickness you have, you'll say, I'll keep that and avoid this room, right? So we want it to look more like this. This is what we want our operating room to look like. Just pure, pristine, untainted, right? Because when somebody has to have an operation, it's because they're not well. And the idea is that the operation will help them to get well. But if while they're being operated on, they come in contact with germs or viruses or any other kind of creepy, crawly, sick things, they could end up worse off than they were before the operation. So, with the gospel, there is a gospel, there is good news about God's salvation through Jesus Christ because people aren't well. We as the human race, we're not well. We're fallen by nature. We make choices that are self-destructive. We get bound up with addictions and all sorts of other things that just we're wrecked, and we're wrecking things, right? And so there's a gospel because we're not well, and we need the gospel to be pure so that it can make us well. And if we're exposed that isn't actually the gospel, we could be worse off than we were before we heard it. Right. So it's imperative that we as the church, the gospel's purity is the church's priority. So wherever the gospel spreads, it's imperative that we preserve, that we protect its purity. That's the overarching theme for what we're going to look at this morning. But there's all sorts of things in here that are just great stuff. So if you have your Bibles, open them up, Acts chapter 8. And we're going to jump back into verse 4 to set the table right, and then we'll read through verse 25, which is our text. Okay, it says, now, those who were scattered went about preaching the word. Philip went down to the city of Samaria and proclaimed to them the Christ. And the crowds with one accord paid attention to what was being said by Philip when they heard him and saw the signs that he did. For unclean spirits, crying out with a loud voice, came out of many who had them, and many who were paralyzed or lame were healed. So there was much joy in the city. But there was a man named Simon who had previously practiced magic in the city and amazed the people of Samaria, saying that he himself was somebody great. They all paid attention to him, from the least to the greatest, saying, this man is the power of God that is called great. And they paid attention to him because for a long time he had amazed them with his magic. But when they believed Philip as he preached the good news about the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. Even Simon himself believed, and after being baptized, he continued with Philip, and seeing signs and great miracles performed, he was amazed. Now, when the apostles at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they sent to them Peter and John, who came down and prayed for them, that they might receive the Holy Spirit, for he had not yet fallen on any of them, but they had only been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then they laid their hands on them, and they received the Holy Spirit. Now, when Simon saw that the Spirit was given through the laying on of the apostles' hands, he offered them money, saying, give me this power also so that anyone on whom I lay my hands may receive the Holy Spirit. But Peter said to him, may your silver perish with you because you thought you could obtain the gift of God with money. You have neither part nor lot in this matter, for your heart is not right before God. Repent, therefore, of this wickedness of yours and pray to the Lord that if possible, the intent of your heart may be forgiven you. For I see that you are in the gall of bitterness and in the bond of iniquity. And Simon answered, pray for me to the Lord that nothing of what you have said may come upon me. Now when they had testified and spoken the word of the Lord, they returned to Jerusalem, preaching the gospel to many villages of the Samaritans. Okay, so back to verse 4, back to verse 5. The church is scattered because of the persecution. And as they shared the good news of God's salvation, they kept it clean, right? That's where we're at. Philip, who was one of the seven that we looked at from Acts chapter 6, was chosen to feed the widows. He was like Stephen, didn't just stay within the realms of that particular ministry. He was useful to God in other ways. So Stephen went about preaching the gospel and he gave his life for it. Philip, one of the other seven, he goes on to Samaria and he brings the gospel to them. So it said, look back to verse 5. Look at this first section. He went down to the city of Samaria. If you look at it on a map, it's north, but because it's a lower elevation, he went down to Samaria. Samaria is about 35 miles north of Jerusalem, so it's quite a little trek. And he brings the gospel to them, and he's proclaiming to them the Christ. Now remember, it says in verse 4 that they went, all who were scattered went about preaching the word. So now we get a little more clarification. That word would be the word of God, right? And now we get a little more clarification that he went about and he proclaimed to them the Christ. So last week when I talked about that the Old Testament finds the message of the Old Testament is the message of Jesus Christ, the idea that all that was taking place in the progressive revelation of God's redemptive story that we see outlined in the Old Testament finds its kind of grand crescendo and its fulfillment in the person of Jesus Christ. Right? So when we look back to the Old Testament now, we see it through the lens of the New Testament and realize God was fulfilling all of his promises in that way. So Old Testament, super important, right? Because it reveals, super important for many reasons, but the main reason, the most important reason is it shows us who Jesus is, who he is for us as the Son of God and the Savior of the world. So this, the word that they're preaching is just that. And it says here in verse 5 that he proclaimed to them the Christ, right? So now again, we got to stick with the text. And the crowds with one accord paid attention to what was being said by Philip when they heard him and saw the signs that he did. So this is how we'd say this. A full gospel ministry gets people's full attention. So what's the full gospel ministry here? First, he's proclaiming to them the Christ, and then we're seeing these miracles. And then the result is there was joy in the city. So this is like a picture of the full gospel. It's the message of Christ that brings salvation. It's the working of miracles that were taking place through Philip. Now remember, we saw these same miracles being done, these same sorts of miracles being done by Stephen that were also being done by the apostles that were also being done by Jesus. And so when Luke wrote his gospel, the gospel of Luke, he said, I'm writing to you to tell you about all that Jesus began to do and to teach. Then we get into the book of Acts, which is the sequel to the book of Luke, the gospel of Luke. He writes, basically, here's the ministry of Jesus continued through the church by the Spirit. So the miracles that Jesus was doing, then he authorizes and empowers his apostles to do it, but not just them. In Mark's gospel, it says, these signs will follow those who believe. And these are the sorts of things that are listed there in Mark 16. So we see that these miracles were not relegated just to the apostles. This sort of thing was taking place in and through the church by God, right? God was doing these things. So they're hearing the good news of Jesus Christ. They're seeing the power of God at work among people, and then they're experiencing the joy of the Lord. This is a full gospel ministry. But let's talk about the gospel for just a minute. Bring this first verse up here. Titus chapter 3. It says, "For we ourselves were once foolish." Now, it's being spoken in the past tense because it's being written to Christians. So the Apostle Paul is the author here, and he's writing to one of his kind of his protege, kind of one of the guys he was raising up for the ministry, Titus, and he's saying, he's giving a testimony as to what it was like before this person had received the gospel, or any person had received the gospel. "For we ourselves were once foolish, disobedient, led astray, slaves to various passions and pleasures, passing our days in malice and envy, hated by others and hating one another." That's a description of the human race, right? There's more that could be said, but in summary, that's why there's good news, friends. That's not good news, but that's the reality that we find ourselves in. That's the part that grounds us, that sobers us to realize our position before God, that we're not acceptable to God because we were once all this. But next verse, go to this next verse. "But when the goodness and loving kindness of God our Savior appeared, he saved us, not because of works done by us in righteousness, but according to his own mercy." So friends, this is the message that Philip was proclaiming. This is the message that Jesus said has got to spread around the whole earth because God wants his family to grow. God wants more and more people to hear the good news, to receive his grace, to be welcomed, to be forgiven, to be welcomed into his family. He doesn't want people to remain estranged from him, foolish, disobedient, enslaved to various passions and pleasures. He wants to express, and he has in Christ, his goodness and loving kindness, right? He wants to express that to every single one of us, his goodness and loving kindness, not because we're so good, but because we're not. And that's the purity of the gospel. So when we talk about wherever the gospel spreads, its purity must be preserved. This is that gospel. If we tell people, if all we do is tell people, "Oh, you're just so wonderful and you're just so great and you're all that and a bag of chips and everything," they have no idea why they need to be saved because they just think they're wonderful. But this is the testimony of the gospel, friends, that we're not all that and a bag of chips, right? That we need a Savior, that we need to be set free from that which is enslaving us, that our disobedience is not acceptable to God. And so he would to show us his goodness and his loving kindness, that I could be saved is unbelievable, except Jesus, right? And you could be saved too, if you're not. It's not about the works of righteousness done by us, those good things that we have or haven't done. It's not about that at all. It's by God's mercy. It's by God's mercy. So the gospel's purity must be preserved, and that's part of it, friends. This is what they're hearing when Philip comes to Samaria and preaches to them, that they need to be reconciled to God because they're estranged from him due to their sin, right? Look at this next verse. It says, here in 2 Corinthians 5:19, that is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. Philip's owning this. Philip's saying, I have been reconciled to God, and I want to go over to Samaria and to anywhere else that God would lead me and bring the message of reconciliation to those people who are not my people, but they need the gospel because God wants them to be his people. Does that make sense? So God is reconciling the world to himself in Christ by his goodness and loving kindness, by his mercy. And he's not counting. Think about the things that you've done that you don't want anybody else, you hope nobody else knows about. Think about the things that you've done that people do know about that you wish they didn't know about. Think about those things that when your conscience is at all active, you realize, oh my goodness, I am a sinner. That verse says that God will not count that against you. He will not count your transgressions against you. That's good news, friends. That's good news. Not because you're great. Not because you're just all that and a bag of chips. Not because of that. But because of his goodness, his loving kindness, because of his mercy. It's not based on what we have done. It's based on what Christ has done. That's the purity of the gospel. And if we switch that around and we cease to understand that and proclaim that, then the purity of the gospel is not preserved, and we invert it, and it becomes a works-based religion that is no good, friends. It's no good, because you can't get reconciled to God on a works-based religion. So this is what they're hearing. This full gospel ministry, they're hearing the good news of Jesus Christ, that God has sent his Son to be the Savior of the world, that he's not counting men's sins against them because when they trust in Christ. And they're seeing the power of God. Like, this is pretty spectacular, right? They're paying attention because of what they're hearing and because of what they're seeing. People with unclean spirits, demonic powers oppressing them, they're being delivered from that. That's taking place, right? Many, it says here, look at this. These unclean spirits with a loud cry came out of many. What do you do? Like, our job is to not take some sort of a theological framework and superimpose it on the Bible and then read it through that lens. Our job is to try to not do that, to look at the Bible for what it says. It says that with a loud cry, these unclean spirits came out of many who had them. And many who were paralyzed or lame were healed. Now, I wish it said all. Like, I'd like it to say all. It doesn't say all. It says many. I don't understand that. Maybe you do. But that's puzzling to me. And I've got to trust the sovereignty of God, that he knows what he's doing. And just because I don't know everything that he's doing doesn't mean he doesn't. Amen. Right? Many, it says. And so there was much joy in that city. This whole gospel is proclaimed, this full gospel, and the purity of it is being preserved, and these people are experiencing the fruit of that, one of which is the joy of the Lord. There's much joy in that city. So this is what we see in the first part. Now, this next part is important because it talks about whom the gift of salvation is for. Who's this gift for? Look at verse 9. It says, "But there was a man named Simon who had previously practiced magic in the city and amazed the people of Samaria, saying that he himself was somebody great. And they all paid attention to him, from the least to the greatest, saying, 'This man is the power of God that is called great.' And they paid attention to him because for a long time he had amazed them with his magic. But when they believed Philip, as he preached the good news about the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. Verse 13, even Simon himself believed. And after being baptized, he continued with Philip, and seeing signs and great miracles performed, he was amazed." So number two, the gift of salvation is for all who believe. We at times, we like to create categories of people and think that the good news is for some people and not for other people. But according to the Bible, even according to this text, the gift of salvation is for all who believe. This is what we hear about from the Samaritans. Now, that they believed and they were baptized. So when it says they believed, it means they recognized their guilt before God. They were willing to repent of that, of their sin, and turn and put all of their faith and trust in Jesus Christ for being reconciled to God. That's what they, when it says that's what they believed. And then notice, they were baptized. And you've said this before, that this is evidence, once again, that the Bible does not know, the Bible doesn't have a category for somebody who says they're a follower of Christ but hasn't been baptized in water. Every single place we find in scriptures, they believe and then they're baptized. It's because baptism is that public confession. You're telling the gospel story when you go down in the water and you come up out of the water, right? The baptism isn't what saves you. They believed and then they were baptized. But the baptism is your story saying, "I belong to God. I'm in the family," right? So if you are a believer but you haven't been baptized, man, be obedient to the Bible. Just follow the pattern of Scripture. If you're a believer, you're supposed to be baptized. The Samaritans got this, right? So the fact that the Samaritans are believers now, this is incredible. It doesn't seem necessarily strange to us, but for this early church where it was relegated, really, even though Jesus had said this gospel has got to be preached in all the world, right now, up to this point, it's almost exclusively Jewish people that are saved, right? But Jesus told them to go to the ends. Jesus told them it's going to go to Judea and Samaria, but it hadn't yet. And so for Philip, who are not his people, so that these people be the people of God, that's a big thing. And of all Samaritans, who are these Samaritans? Like the Jewish people, there's Jewish people who were living in Jerusalem at that time. They had for millennia preserved their pure bloodline, and they were very proud of that. Well, the Samaritans were half Jewish and half Gentile. And it happened because years before, the Assyrians invaded that land and they leveled the city of Samaria in that region. They carried massive amounts of their people off into slavery, but they left the poorest of the poor, Jews, there. So let me clarify. At the time, they were all Jews. Right? They populated the promised land, but that region, which was a divided kingdom at the time, into way too many details. There was a divided kingdom at the time, and those northern tribes were carried away, Jewish people, but there were repopulated the area with their own people. They were Gentiles, non-Jewish people. And then over time, they intermarried, and this new group of people were created that the Bible calls Samaritans. They Jewish, half Gentile. Well, for us, most of us are a mix of all sorts of different nations and races and all of that. And so it's like kind of normal for us. We don't hardly think anything of it. But for the Jewish people in the Bible days, this was big stuff. They didn't like that whatsoever. And because they didn't like the Samaritans, well, of course, why would the Samaritans like the Jews? So there's a major rift going on here. And what we find is even the Samaritans can be Christians, right? Even the people that these Jewish people are like, am I going to go to them people? Does God even love the Samaritans? No, they shouldn't wonder that, actually. Think about if you're familiar with the gospel accounts. In John chapter 4, it's a record of Jesus who had to go through Samaria. He's been up in Galilee, he's going down to Jerusalem, he had to go through Samaria. And he meets the woman at the well. You remember that account? He meets the woman at the well who happens to be a Samaritan. And he tells her all these things about herself that she didn't want anybody else to know. And she's like, you got to be a prophet. And Jesus says, I'm more than a prophet, lady. My paraphrase. She realizes that he's the Christ. He's the Messiah. Samaritans still believed in a coming Messiah. And so she's like, whoa, this is unbelievable. I found the Messiah. She goes back to her village, says, I think I just found the one God's promised. Come on out. They believe her testimony. They come out and they hang out with Jesus for a little bit. And they look to her and they say, well, we initially believed because you told us, but we don't believe anymore because you told us. We've been with Jesus and we know it to be true. So some of these Samaritans, they were some of the earliest followers of Christ. They had put their faith in Christ. So John chapter 4, we get that. What is it? Luke 17, I believe, where if you're familiar with the account, there are 10 lepers who are coming into the town, and Jesus sees them, and he speaks words and heals them. And 9 of them continue into town. They don't even stop and say thank you. Like, could you believe it? And Jesus says, only one returned to give thanks, and he was a Samaritan, right? So the disciples are all with Jesus when this is happening. They don't have to wonder whether Jesus cares about Samaritans. One of his most powerful parables is recorded in Luke 10 about the parable of the good Samaritan. He told it about a Samaritan because he knew the Jews didn't like the Samaritans, but he wanted to make sure they understood what it means to be a neighbor. And so he says, act like the Samaritan here. And they're like, we don't even like Samaritans, right? So we don't have to wonder whether Jesus cares about the Samaritans and whether his salvation is for them. But for the church in this moment, this was big. This was big, big stuff. But then, go look back to verse 13. Even Simon himself believed and was baptized. Now, this is a challenge. Oh, my goodness, friends. This is a dilemma. I was on the horns of a dilemma this week. Because you think you understand a passage of Scripture until you have to preach it and study it in the way that you have to preach it. And hours and hours and hours goes into this. You talk off the cuff. It doesn't happen that way, just so you know. So I'm wrestling with this passage of Scripture. And I'm going, because I always study it myself first before I look at any commentaries. I'm wrestling through the text and looking at the language and history and all of that. And I'm like, what do I do with Simon? Because when you read, which we've already done, when you look at the rebuke that Peter offers to him, that's harsh. That's heavy. That's a one heavy message that Peter gives to him. And when you read some commentaries, they will say Simon wasn't a real believer. Peter wouldn't have talked to him that way. Again, our job is not to take our theological position and superimpose it on Scripture and see it through that lens. Our job is to try not to do that and just read the Bible, study it, and try to understand it for what it says. And so I had to wrestle through this. I'm like, is Simon a believer or not? Is he saved? Is this legitimate? You know where I landed? Even Simon. That's what it says. The Samaritans all believed. And Luke says, even Simon himself believed. Same word without qualification. He doesn't say even Simon believed, but he didn't really mean it. Or it was kind of a false pseudo belief, and we'll see that he's going to fall apart here in just a little bit. That's not what it says. It says even Simon himself was believed and was baptized. Who's Philip? Philip's one of the seven, right? Philip is one who was said to be full of the Holy Spirit and wisdom. My hope is that Philip realized he wouldn't baptize somebody if he didn't know they weren't saved. If he didn't know they were saved, he'd have to have that confidence, right? And so it says simply, Simon himself believed. Even Simon, the gospel, the gift of salvation is for all who believe, and the Samaritans believed, and Simon believed. Now, this is important, because when you get back over to the first verse in this section, in verse 9, we're told who Simon is, that he was a man who previously practiced magic in the city. Now, just for the sake of, maybe this is clear to you, maybe it's not, but this is not like a magic trick. This is not an illusion. He's not up there like in front of the Samaritans going, look at these cards, pick a card. You know, pulling a rabbit out of the hat. He's not doing any of that. This is the word for this is sorcery, right? So let me define that term for you. To perform magic spells that harness occult forces or evil spirits to produce unnatural effects in the world, right? So this isn't trickery, sleight of hand. This isn't, you know, this is no illusion. Simon is a sorcerer. He's performing magic. He's conjuring up evil spirits, and occult practices are taking place. This is who Simon is. And again, you don't have to wonder when we look back to the first part of our passage where unclean spirits, you wonder, why are so many people being oppressed by demonic spirits in this community? Well, could it possibly be because they've all been amazed at Simon, the sorcerer, for all of these years, who's opened their lives up to this occult practice? And now they're being delivered by a power that's far greater than these dark forces, right? Magic or sorcery is forbidden by God for good reason, because it has its origins in satanic power and opens a person's life up to demonic forces. Look at this verse, Deuteronomy 18. So, quick context. Deuteronomy means the second law. God is giving the Jewish people, the children of Israel, the law again because they got it in Exodus on their way to the promised land, but because of their rebellion, they weren't allowed to go into the promised land. They wandered for 40 years learning a single lesson that you're not to live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. An entire generation of people pass away, and now they're being primed to go into the promised land again. The promise of going in is being offered to them again. And this is what Moses is saying to them, Deuteronomy 18. There shall not be found among you, among the people of God, anyone who practices divination or tells fortunes or interprets omens or a sorcerer or a charmer or a medium or a necromancer or one who inquires of the dead, for whoever does these things is an abomination to the Lord. That means it's detestable to God. And because of these abominations, the Lord your God is driving them out before you. You shall be blameless before the Lord your God. For these nations which you are about to dispossess, listen to fortune tellers and diviners. But as for you, the Lord your God has not allowed you to do this. In our culture, we're not that much different than the Samaritans in this way. In our culture, there's this fascination with dark forces. There's this, part of it's playful. We think, oh, fortune telling and horoscopes and tarot cards and all of those things, they're like not that big of a deal. They're just kind of fun to goof around with and play with, but it's actually forbidden. The Lord your God has not allowed you to do this. Why? Because he's protecting you. Because he doesn't want our lives opened up to demonic forces. That's what's taking place here. So we go, whoa, this Simon guy, he's no, you know, illusionist, rabbit out of the hat trick. He's a bad guy. And even Simon, the gift of salvation is even for Simon because he's believed, right? And this is part of ensuring that we preserve the purity of the gospel. If we think in our hearts that we can start picking and choosing the type of people that God should save, oh my goodness, friends, talk about offensive to the cross, right? So we've got to do our part preserving the purity of the gospel. Okay, look at this next section. Man, I told you we're going to be challenged by these things. This is a challenging passage of scripture. So far, so good. Are you challenged so far? Okay, so, again, can I back up? Just as an aside, I just love the language of this. Verse 9, about Simon, who is saying that he himself is somebody great. I just love that, right? He's the one that's saying that he's great. Boy, what a guy, huh? Even Simon, the guy with the inflated ego, He could be saved, baptized, and then but also it's important to note that he continued with Philip. That's a word of devotion, that he devoted himself to Philip. Seeing signs and great miracles performed, he was amazed. So the people were amazed by Simon because of all of his magic, sorcery, and now all of those people are, including Simon, are amazed at what Philip's doing. Not because Philip is somebody projecting himself to be somebody great, but because the gospel is great, because the full gospel ministry is on display, and they're amazed at this. They're seeing a power that they've been exposed to, power, supernatural power, but not like this before. This is real, true, powerful stuff. All right. So, verse 14. Now, when the apostles at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they sent to them Peter and John, who came down and prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Spirit, for he had not yet fallen on any of them, but they had only been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then they laid their hands on them, and they received the Holy Spirit. Stop right there. So, we see here that being empowered by the Spirit, like salvation, is a gift from God. But notice, again, this is about preserving the purity of the gospel. The apostles were commissioned, specific, chosen by Christ, commissioned by Christ. Ephesians tells us that the church, the church is built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets. Christ Jesus himself is the cornerstone. So the apostles have this special place, this apostolic authority in the life and history of the church. Now that the gospel has spread somewhere beyond the Jewish people, it's important for the church to make sure that they're validating this is the right, this is a work of God. Otherwise, because of this rift that existed with the Samaritans, they could have said, well, you're the church in Jerusalem that follows Christ, and we're a different church in Samaria that follows Christ. And that can't happen, friends. That's not what it's supposed to be. We're all under the banner of Christ. And so they send the apostles there so that they could see this is the work of God, that this is truly a gospel work. But notice that the Samaritans had already received salvation. They believed and were baptized. But they hadn't received the gift of the Spirit, which, if we go back, we remember Luke 24, Acts chapter 1, Jesus said, wait until you receive, he's talking to his followers, wait until you receive power from on high, wait until you receive the baptism in the Holy Spirit so you'll be empowered to be my witnesses. Right? Let's look at that verse, Acts chapter 1, verse 4 and 5. And while staying with them, he ordered them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father. That's a key phrase. Wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, you heard from me, for John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. So the promise of the Father is the baptism in the Holy Spirit. You see it? So we've already identified that salvation is a gift from God, and this is also. Then go to the next verse. Now, this is after the Spirit's come down, this is on the day of Pentecost, they're all together, they're praying, the Holy Spirit is poured out, and everybody that the Spirit is poured out on begins to speak in these unlearned languages. A crowd of people gather around and they ask, what is this? And Peter then preaches the first Christian sermon and he says, this is what was spoken of by the prophet Joel, that in the last days, God says, I will pour out my Spirit upon all people. And so he goes through this whole sermon and he gets to the end, right toward the end, and he says, for the promise, that's the promise of the Father, the baptism of the Holy Spirit, the promise is for you and for your children and for all who are far off, everyone whom the Lord our God calls to himself. So he's saying, even the Samaritans? Yep. That's why the apostles are there. To make sure that they're able to say, this is the work, God has called these people to himself. This is for all who are afar off. So this being empowered by the Spirit, like salvation, is a gift from God. They had already received salvation, and now they receive this other gift, this baptism in the Holy Spirit, the gift of the Spirit, right? So it's interesting. Again, when we look at this, in our day and age, we have all sorts of lenses that this is viewed from, right? And many of you have different backgrounds in churches that you grew up in, and I have my backgrounds. And so the idea is, what we want to do is we want to make sure we're just study. Let's stick with the text. There's no question that Samaritans are believers. They've been baptized, right? There's no question. It says that he, masculine pronoun, the Holy Spirit, had not yet fallen on them. So there are some who would say that the baptism in the Holy Spirit happens at salvation, that the indwelling of the Spirit of God dwells in you at salvation. Well, we would say, yes, most definitely, most definitely. We know that to be true. Romans 8 tells us that if the Spirit of God does not dwell within you, you don't belong to God. It's the way we know that we're the children of God. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we're the children of God. But being indwelt by the Spirit, these Samaritans are indwelt by the Spirit, they're believers. But being indwelt by the Spirit and being filled with the Spirit or baptized in the Spirit aren't the same thing. Not in the book of Acts, they're not. Right? So again, we're taking the text for what it is. And some of you are like, wait a second. And I'm saying, let's just study the text. They're believers, but they're not baptized in the Spirit until Peter and John come down, right? So, and they came down that they might receive the Spirit. That's verse 15, right? Because he hadn't yet fallen on any of them. They'd only been baptized in the name of the Lord. And they lay their hands on them. It's kind of an act of acceptance and commissioning, and they receive the Holy Spirit. So the gift of the Spirit is given after the gift of salvation. So all of the people that were baptized in the Spirit in Acts chapter 2, they were all believers. and then they were baptized in the Holy Spirit. When we see it here, we could see it again, just like that. It's subsequent to, the baptism of the Spirit is subsequent to salvation. Then when we see it again laid out in Acts chapter 10, when the gospel gets to the Gentiles, to the ends of the earth, we see once again, but it happens so immediately there that you could actually say, oh, see right there, it happened with salvation. But if you look at it, you're like, wait a second, why did it happen different here in Samaria than it did in the house of Cornelius, Acts chapter 10? Well, in Samaria, there's no apostles. They got to validate the purity of the gospel message. In the house of Cornelius, Peter's there, right? And so he gets through the whole gospel. They're saved. The Spirit of God falls on them. And that, again, is witness to, and we'll get there in a couple weeks, but that's witness to the apostles preserving the purity of the gospel and not getting to choose who gets it. God, in Peter's own confession, God showed us they received the same gift we did when we were baptized in the Spirit on the day of Pentecost. That was Peter's testimony from the house of Cornelius, when he was questioned about even going into the household of a Gentile. So again, we just look at this and we go, this is challenging, right? Do we have faith for this? The gift of the Spirit is given to those who ask for it. How do we know? Well, we get to verse 18 and we see that Simon saw something. It says in verse 18 that when Simon saw that the Spirit was given through the laying on of the apostles' hands. Now, it wasn't always given through the laying on of the apostles' hands. It was given in other ways, so that's the most important, but that's what he saw. But you think, what did he actually see? Because he's already seeing signs and wonders, so it's not signs and wonders again that's got his attention. He saw something else, and you have to wonder, what is it that he saw? We could only speculate, but by the testimony of the rest of the book of Acts, where when people were baptized with the Spirit, they spoke in an unlearned language, that's kind of what you have to almost kind of conclude, right? Again, not to superimpose that on the text, but he saw something. There wasn't nothing taking place. It wasn't this quiet little prayer moment and they all just went, oh, okay, that's great. Simon wasn't interested in that. That's not what got his attention, right? So there's something going on here, right? It's pretty powerful. Again, do we have faith for this? So here's how I would say this. Salvation is God's gift to the world that we might become his children. Salvation is God's gift to the world that they might become his children. The baptism in the Holy Spirit, God's gift to his children that they might become his witnesses to the world. So when we talk about living inside out at City Point Church, where we live the gospel with those inside the family and we bring the gospel to those outside the family, it's part kind of this, isn't it? That we want to be used of God to be his witnesses to the world so that they can come into the family. That's the heart of God in this. So again, they're preserving the purity of the gospel because the church isn't operating on its own power. The church is operating on the power of God, the power of the Spirit, right? And they're preserving the purity of the gospel in this way. That it's the truth of what's taking place here has been validated. It's the apostles are present. And the necessity of the gift of the Spirit, the church operating in the power of God, very important. Now, our final portion is about sanctification. It's about us becoming like Christ. And this, again, I'm challenged by this. Very challenging. Look at verse 18. Let's read it. Now, when Simon saw that the Spirit was given through the laying on of the apostles' hands, he offered them money, saying, "Give me this power also, that anyone on whom I lay my hands may receive the Holy Spirit." But Peter said to him, "May your silver perish with you, because you thought you could obtain the gift of God with money. You have neither part nor lot in this matter, for your heart is not right before God. Repent, therefore, of this wickedness of yours and pray to the Lord that, if possible, the intent of your heart may be forgiven you. For I see that you were in the gall of bitterness and in the bond of iniquity." And Simon answered, "Pray for me to the Lord that nothing of what you have said may come upon me." Now, when they had testified, last kind of summary verse, when they had testified, spoken the word of the Lord, they returned, that's Peter and John, returned to Jerusalem, preaching the gospel to many villages of the Samaritans. So they see, oop, the gospel has reached the Samaritans. We better go throughout the villages of Samaria, bring the gospel to them. By the way, this is the last time we hear of the Apostle John in the book of Acts. That's it. He falls off the pages of the book of Acts. We never hear of him again, right? So what do we have here? Here's how I would say this. Point number four, belonging to Christ and becoming like Christ are not simultaneous events. There are some who would say, based on Peter's rebuke, there's no way Simon is a believer. But Luke says he was a believer. So we could only surmise that he wasn't. But when Luke says he's a believer, just like the Samaritans are believers, we have to take that for what it is. Now, why is Peter so heavy here? Why is he so like, whoa, my goodness, he goes from 0 to 60 in 2.1 seconds, right? Well, part of it's Peter's personality, right? If you're familiar, if you've ever studied the life of Peter, you go, this is Peter, right? He's very prophet-like. And Peter's familiar himself with some pretty harsh rebukes. When Jesus says, I'm going to the cross for the salvation of the world, Peter says, no, you're not. And Jesus says, get behind me, Satan. Are we to suppose now that Peter is not a believer because Jesus just rebuked him, calling him Satan? He said, you don't have in mind the things of God, but the things of men. Well, Simon the sorcerer, the former sorcerer, is really no different here. He has in mind not the things of God, but the things of men. This is Simon the former sorcerer. I got to keep saying that. This is Simon, the now believer, who is not acting like Christ. He's in Christ, but he's not acting like Christ. He's been born again, but he's still a long way from functioning in the way that he's supposed to. Becoming a Christian isn't the same thing as becoming like Christ, is what we're, so this idea of it's a gradual process, and Simon's desires need to be refined here, no doubt. He's definitely operating out of his old business model. He's operating out of his old patterns, his old habits. And so when he says, if when he saw this, that the Spirit is given through the laying on of the apostles' hands, and he says, give me this, if he would have, like, he could have, that could be a legitimate desire to be used by God by that, in that way, to see, to want people to experience the power of God in that way, that could be a very legitimate desire. But he offers them money. So that's his old mode of thinking, like he's off his rocker at this point, and Peter nails him for it. Why? Because the purity of the gospel is the church's priority. Peter's like, you will not, money and the gospel don't mingle. You can't offer the gifts of God based on money. I mean, think about the Reformation, right? 500 years ago, the church goes through a Reformation in large part because the church was off its rocker. The preservation of the purity of the gospel had been lost. And Martin Luther, who was himself a Roman Catholic monk, and a priest was trying to reform the church from within, saying, these things shall not be. You cannot guarantee people salvation because they give you money. Repentance is by faith. Salvation is by faith through repentance and trust in Christ. And he couldn't do it. So that starts the Reformation because they had not preserved the purity of the gospel. Peter's like, you can't offer the gifts of God with money, right? And so he says, you have no part in this matter. In what matter? His own salvation? No, we're already told he's a believer. In the matter of being able to be used by God in the giving of the gift of God, the baptism in the Spirit, right? That's the matter. He says, you'll have no part or lot in this matter, for your heart is not right with God. So his desires they need to be refined. His ego certainly needs to be deflated. His old habits need to be reformed. I mean, think about it. Just think about it in your own life. For those of you that are believers, have all of your motives and all of your words and all of your actions been right since you've been a believer? No. And if you say that they are, that they have been, the rest of us say, liar, liar, pants on fire. Right? There's no way, friends, not even this week, have all of our actions, words, motives, all of those things been pure. So this is the idea that, man, Simon, we're told he's a believer, but he's rebuked. And when I read his response in verse 24, I think that this is a guy who's feeling the weight of his own guilt, his stupidity, like he didn't realize what he was doing. He reverted to his old ways, and he was then now all of a sudden, because Peter's so sharp with him, so quick, Now he feels the weight of that, and he's like remorseful. Peter says, you pray to God. And Simon's like, pray for me. I don't even know if I want to pray to God. So what are we to conclude here? That he's not saved? No, I think we conclude that he is saved. But he needs to change. He needs to grow. There's areas in his life that need to be refined, like all of us, right? I mean, if we take Simon, because he was off base on this, if we take that to mean that now his salvation is annulled, friends, salvation is stronger than that. It's more sturdy. It's more secure than that, right? When you read the Corinthian letters, and Paul calls them saints, and then spends volumes correcting them for their idiotic behavior. Like, seriously, you read 1 Corinthians, tell me, you're just like, oh my goodness. You wonder whether they're Christians. Lawsuits and immorality, and they can't. He says at one point, it would be better if you didn't even get together. You can't even get communion right. It'd be better if you didn't come together as a church because you're just messing this up so bad, right? So are we to conclude that they're not saints? No. They were Christians. They just weren't sanctified. Friends, it's real important, those of us who belong to Christ, that we become more and more like Christ. That we're continually reflecting on our lives, continually taking the Word of God in, and allowing God by His Spirit to transform us, changing the way we think about things, giving us a biblical perspective and a biblical worldview, and not just absorbing the things that our culture tells us, and not just saying, well, it's just the way I grew up, or it's just the way I am, I'm Irish, right? Not to pick on Irish people. I got a little Irish blood in me, you know? Anyway, all who come to Christ are to become like Christ. So, let's wrap this up. The good news, God's salvation, wherever the gospel is spread, its purity must be preserved. It's our job too, friends. It's our job too, right? So, let me bring some application to this. There's several things that I could think about as I processed through and kind of prayed through this. So the gospel gets to Samaria because of persecution. Nobody would sign up to be persecuted. But the commission of Christ is being fulfilled because of the hardship the church was going through. And I just would challenge you in your own life. Are you able to see God at work, working His plan even through the hard things in life? Because that's what the church is going through right now. In the book of Acts, the church is going through really hard things, and yet God is fulfilling His will through it all, right? He's using those things. In His sovereignty, He's using those things to get His will accomplished. And I hope that you can see that in faith and trust in the goodness and the loving kindness of God, that you can see, even in the hard things that you're going through in life right now, you can see that somehow, you may not even know what it is that He's trying to accomplish, but you trust that His will is good, pleasing, and perfect, and He's working that in your life, even through those hardships, right? Philip went to a people that weren't his sort of people. He wouldn't have associated with his people except for the gospel, right? So who would you rather not go to? Who would you rather not bring the gospel to? Who would you rather not reconcile with? Who would you rather not serve? Where would you rather not serve? Maybe the Lord's prompting you in that. Again, I've already hit on this, but in the Bible, water baptism followed belief. Right? So if you're not a believer, then I appeal to you. What is keeping you from trusting Christ? God has loved you with an everlasting love. And it is most evident in the sending of His Son. And if you haven't put your trust in Christ, you are at odds with God. You are at enmity with Him. Be reconciled to God. Confess your sin. and receive Christ. It's in his loving kindness and his mercy that your salvation rests. And I would encourage you, if you're ready for that, just talk to us after the gathering, write it on the connection card, and put your trust in Christ. If you're a Christian and you haven't been baptized, man, what are you doing? Like, what are you waiting for? A word from God? Well, we just read a bunch of them. You think I'm kidding? I'm not kidding at all, actually, right? So again, use the connection card. Say, I'm ready to be baptized. I'm a believer. I want to be baptized. Yeah, and we'll do it. Old habits, sinful ways. At times they die hard. Simon got rebuked. But I just say, Lord, if there's any area in my life that you need to rebuke me, whether softly or harshly, let me be open. I want to be changeable. I don't want to be stuck. I don't want to remain unrefined in any area of my life. I want the gospel to have its full work in me. Are you with me on that? So let that be your prayer today. And hey, for some of you, I know this is a challenge. This is an interesting thought. The idea that the baptism of the Holy Spirit follows salvation, because you were, informed a different way. But I would just challenge you to study the scriptures, because it's interesting when you walk through the book of Acts and you see this, and then just pray, just be open to what the Lord might do. It's full gospel ministry. People are being healed, people are being saved, people are being filled with the Spirit, and people are being sanctified. That's the full gospel, friends. And I think, let's be full gospel people. Amen? Lord, thank you for your goodness to us today. We love you. We're grateful for your work in our lives. Thank you for your word today. Help us to do our part in preserving the purity of the gospel in our own souls, in our own homes, in this local church. And do your work among us, Lord. We pray your kingdom come, your will be done. We love you, Lord. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. Amen.